Well, eventually, I finally gave in. And I wrote the check to the one guy, $1,000. I did not do it joyfully. It wasn't like that, First Chronicles passage that we saw there. That was not me. That First Chronicles passage did not describe the way I did this. But you know, we are all at different stages of faith, isn't that right? You know, it's like this is the, you know, that's where the optimum. But we got different stages of faith on the way up there. So we need to start walking. So at least I did it. And then I went to the other guys that wanted to go to Africa. I said, would $1,000 do it? No, we need $1,200. I thought they'd say, oh, $1,000, that's so wonderful. But no, we need $1,200. I said, Holy Spirit's not making this easy. You know, okay, here's $1,200. There they go. And they were jumping around having a good time. And I'm thinking, oh, man. But anyhow, you know, pray for me. I still struggle with this stuff. But anyhow, the interesting thing was, do you think God blessed me and returned that money into my bank account before I needed it? What do you think? No. He didn't. He blessed me, but didn't return the money. But that's what I want to say. God will bless you, and there will be miracles. It may not be financial. I actually did have to keep on working the next year and stuff like that. It was a sacrifice. Is that wrong? If God wants to make sacrifices, wants to love people and to trust Him? No, I didn't get the money. What did happen, though, is very interesting. The chap that went to visit his brother, he came back, and about 2 or 3 weeks after he visited his brother in New York, his brother died in a car accident. He came up to me with tears in his eyes and said, if you hadn't given me that money, I said, I didn't know why I needed to go back to New York. I couldn't explain to you why I had to go back to see my brother in New York, but if you hadn't given me that money, I would not have seen him before he died. Thank you very much. Would you say that's a miracle? Would you say God showed up? Would you say that's a blessing in a sense? The other people gave him the money, came back, whatever. And the interesting thing was, I hadn't seen him. I graduated from seminary, and I eventually ended up in Nanaimo here. And this must have been, since this item happened, probably 10 or 15 years later. He showed up at our ministerial in Nanaimo to make a presentation. I had no idea. And there he was. He remembered me, and I remembered him. And he said, he came up to me, he says, thank you so very much for giving that money to us. He remembered, 15 years later. And he said, you know what? I have been praying for you and your ministry every day since that time. I say that's worth $1,200.
Yeah.
More! Do you know what I'm saying? Yeah, and then... And then he had a book he was selling. He said, I said, oh yeah, I wouldn't mind getting that book. He said, okay, I'll send it to you. So he sent me the book, and he sent me a bill for $25 for the book. Praise the Lord, I like giving, you know what I mean? God's in the business of wanting us to trust Him. And when we trust God more than money, you'll find that God is bigger than money. And the idea is that you don't have to worry, you don't have to be involved with fear, you don't have to manipulate, you don't have to be angry when things don't go your way or things aren't happening the way you want. You don't have to be selfish. You can relax in peace because you're trusting God to take care of things. He's real and alive, and he's alive today, right? He can do anything. And if you haven't discovered the reality of God in your life, you have to step out in faith. But when you do, He'll show up. He'll show up. And the more we constantly we're tempted to rely on the things of this world rather than God. At least I find that. Am I the only one? I constantly have to be challenged to step out in faith and trust Him again and again. I find myself getting worried and anxious about this, that, and the other thing. God says, I don't want you to do that. Trust me. Trust me. And so one of the ways we trust Him is by giving. Giving helps us to trust God. Number three, giving helps us to love others. This is pretty evident, I guess. Luke 6:30, give to everyone who asks you. If anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. 6:35, but love your enemies, he says. Do good to them in the context of giving, and lend to them without expecting anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you'll be sons of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. God is a giver. He gives. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. So He wants us to be like Him. So He's trying to get us into people who are givers, who see other people who have needs, and be willing to sacrifice in order for their welfare. That's a dimension of, would you call that a dimension of love? And so this is a blessing that we can have, to learn how to love like Jesus and like God. It's a wonderful, wonderful blessing. All right. Now, I want to, there's a lot more I could say there, I won't. I want to just talk about some guidelines for giving to God's work. And a lot of these are my guidelines. I didn't find them anywhere. Some of you may even disagree with some of my positions, and that's okay. You know me, I don't get upset with people disagree with me, as long as you bring the Bible, you know, and we'll talk about it. And some of these, I think most of you probably agree with most of what I say. Maybe some of you won't agree with all of what I say. But this is the way I see it. In my study of Scripture over the years, and my own experience in life, this is currently where I stand in terms of guidelines for giving to God's work. First of all, number one, in my opinion, technically, you know, the Old Testament form of giving was there was a law that you were to give a tithe, which is 10%, right? And that was the law in those days. You give 10% of your money. Now, as we reach the New Covenant and the New Testament, a lot of the laws, of course, we're no longer under the law. And God is still very much in the business of us having to give. Obviously, it's huge in the New Testament, the giving spirit. But technically, you will not find, if you look at the New Testament, technically you will not find the teaching of giving 10%. It may be that God wants us to give more than 10%. You won't find that, at least in my opinion. And I am supported by, you'd find the same kind of comments with the Billy Graham Association, Moody Bible Institute, Chuck Swindoll, John MacArthur, J. Vernon McGee, Theodore Epp, and a number of others, evangelicals, who would say that that's true. Technically, there's not a command in the New Testament for us to give 10% of our income. The Billy Graham Association, I've got there on the next quote, if I can put there. It says, well, how should we give? Well, a New Testament teaching on giving, which may be helpful, is found in 1 Corinthians 16:2. This passage brings out 4 points. We should give individually, regularly, methodically, and proportionately. The matter of your giving is between you and God. 1 Corinthians 16:2, on the first day of every week, that's kind of regularly and methodically. Each one of you, that's every one of us kind of thing, should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income. In other words, you give what you're able to give in terms of the income that you have. And that's kind of a principle that I think is more New Testament, as it were, than saying, no, you need to give 10%. All right, here's my second principle that I have here. However, tithing 10%, it's no longer a law for the Christian, in my opinion. But it may be a beneficial universal financial principle. So what are you talking about? Well, for example, one of the Ten Commandments is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. That's a law. And the Sabbath was from Friday sunset to Saturday sunset. And if you did any work in during that period of time, you were sinning. It was wrong. Okay. Do we obey that command today? No. We're no longer under that law. However, let me ask this question. Usually when God gave laws, it wasn't because he wanted to hurt us, he wanted to help us. Is it a good thing for a person to take one day out of the week and get out of the rat race and rest, maybe focus on God, focus on your family, and just relax? Is that a good thing, do you think? Huge. Huge. God probably created us that way, that we needed a one day in seven kind of break and rest. Okay, no longer a law, but a principle. Don't have to do it. Not a major sin. You know, I don't keep Friday sunset to Saturday sunset anymore. Even if sometimes we transfer it to Sunday, but you know, nowhere in the Scripture says we have to do that either. But it's like it's a principle, and you find in the Old Testament, before the law was given even, there was a chap called Melchizedek. That's a funny name, isn't it? But Abraham made some money by conquering some people. Do that stuff in those days. And he said, I want to give 10% of everything I've got, and I want to give it to God. And there was this chap called Melchizedek who wasn't even an Israelite. He was Gentile. And he gave 10% to God through Melchizedek.